No matter what type of software development methodology you use, you'll always get this famous question from upper management, middle management, your customers. When will this be done? I've talked with many Scrum Masters about this topic. Many struggle with this question. You see, in Agile, in Scrum, we work in sprints, in iterations, and at the end of a sprint, we want to maximize value that we can deliver to the customer, to the end user. That's why we work towards delivering a working version, a working increment at the end of a sprint. A sprint is usually 2 weeks, 4 weeks, a working version that can be used by the customer, by the end user, at the end of a sprint. 2 weeks. But what if a complex solution is being developed? A complex solution that would require multiple sprints, 5 sprints, 10 sprints. How do you predict the release dates for all these versions coming? What do you tell the customer when they ask you, when will the product be delivered? When will I be able to use the full version of a product? Well, in this video, we're going to talk exactly about this. By the end of this video, you'll know exactly how to do release planning in Scrum. Agile release planning is a product management method where you plan releases, incremental releases of a product. Remember the classic waterfall, the traditional method. You don't release incrementally. We release major releases. We do major releases, a big bang approach. Compared to release planning in Agile, where you break down the releases into sprints, you release at the end of each sprint an incremental, a working version of an increment at the end of each sprint. And depending on the project size, depending on the scope, on the team size, you might even have multiple sprints being done at the same time. As an example, think of writing a book. At each end of a sprint, you'll have a new draft, a new version of this book, an updated draft. And this draft can be reviewed by your publisher, by your customer, if someone is paying you to write the book. But it doesn't mean that you will publish the book to the public, that you will give access to the book to the public. Doesn't mean that. Just means that at the end of each sprint, you will have a latest version, a latest draft. Now with release planning, you will be able to plan and predict how you will release versions of a book to the public. The problem with using Scrum is that there's no guide on how to do release planning. With Scrum, if you read the latest version of a Scrum guide, the 2020 version, there's no mention of a release planning, of release planning. But there was previously, there was in 2011, release planning was removed from the Scrum guide. Here's a quote talking about the rationale behind this decision of removing it from the Scrum guide. The previous version of a Scrum guide described a lot about what has to be done. However, describing the what closes the door on alternative and possible better approaches. In contrast, describing the why prompts people to think for themselves on how to apply the concepts in their own unique context. Removing much of the what from the Scrum guide also prevents copy-paste behavior. Blindly following the rules without understanding them just because it happened to be successful in another situation. Quite flexible here, a Scrum guide concerning release planning. And because of this, there's a few ways to do that. Here's my preferred approach. The very first thing to do is to ensure that the product backlog is in a good state, it's updated. All the valuable things, most valuable things for the customer are on top of a product backlog. Once this is true, it's time to give a rough estimation of a product backlog, the work that needs to be done. Usually done at the epic level. You don't need to estimate all the user stories, all the tests. No, estimate it, rough estimation, high-level estimation at the epic level. Then you decide on the length of an iteration or of a sprint. 2 weeks, 4 weeks, you decide. I would recommend 2 weeks. Most people go for 2 weeks, but you can try to do it in 4 weeks also. Remember, if you change the length of a sprint at any time during the course of the project, or when you're still in the release plan that you did, you need to recalculate the sprint capacity, and you need to change the dates of the schedule in terms of when you're going to release the product increments. Next is to agree with the team on the velocity to be used in this prediction, in this release planning. We usually take the average velocity of a previous three sprints of a team. It's a good measure, something that you can use because it's fresh, and you can use that to predict future releases. If you don't have this data because it's a new team, make an educated guess based on the data that you currently have. The next thing to do is to insert a fudge factor in the equation. Most people miss this. That's why most projects are delayed. Most people miss this, and this causes them to overestimate what they can do over a period. A fudge factor, when inserted, basically covers the uncertainty, the error part of the equation. What you can see on the screen right now is the cone of uncertainty. Just look at the difference between the beginning of a project, when there's a lot of unknowns, and the end of a project. The more we go through the project, the more we know about the project, the more we start developing, start getting used to the development tools, to the way of working together as a team, the more we know about user stories, the less uncertainty. And at the end of a project, when we are very close to release, there's not a lot of uncertainty. That's why we need this fudge factor. And usually, depending on the project, depending on what is known, 60%, 80%, pretty good. That's a pretty good range. So if you have a velocity of 100, let's say the team works at a pace of 100 every sprint, if you apply a fudge factor of 80%, it means that the true velocity here is only 80 instead of 100. Now that we have a true velocity of a team, we can calculate how many sprints are needed to release the entire thing. We have a product backlog, we divide it by this true velocity, and we should have the number of sprints required to complete everything in the product backlog, assuming that everything in the product backlog is related to a release. Make sure that this is true. Let's look at the real life example here. You've estimated all the items in the product backlog, a rough estimate, and the total product backlog is 200 points. The velocity of a team, 20 points. The average of the last three sprints, 20 points. You do always do around 20 points of the velocity of a team. Now, fudge factor, a lot of unknowns in the project. So you use a fudge factor of 60%. 0.6, that's not 20 points now, it's 12. So the real velocity of a team is 12. Now, how do you know how many sprints? Remember the calculation. You take the amount of points, the total amount of points in the product backlog, 200. You divide it by the velocity, which is 12, and you get the amount of sprints needed. And in this example, 200 divided by 12 is 17. 17 sprints required to complete the project. Now, we already know a sprint. We decided for this project that a sprint would be 2 weeks. You multiply 17 by 2 to get the amount of weeks required to complete this project. And in this example, 17 multiplied by 2 is 34. 34 weeks, required to complete everything in the product backlog. Now, that's a prediction. It's an estimate. It's a release plan. It's not something that your sponsors, customers, upper management can force you to meet. A prediction, an estimate, is always off, I would say. It's very rare that you'll get that right. And it's normal. It's normal because there are so many unknowns. But with all the data that you currently have and adding a factor, a fudge factor, it should be pretty close to the real thing, what would really happen when you start with a project. Remember, when we work with Scrum, it shouldn't be a big bang approach. You shouldn't have 800 items in your product backlog. And when you do a release plan, the first release is in 1 year. That's the waterfall model. You should be releasing at least every month. If you can release every sprint to the customer, that would be ideal. But if you can release every month, please do it. Get feedback. We do this to get feedback from the customer. And with this feedback, we can make informed decisions based on that feedback. Obviously, if the feedback of a customer is telling you about the product, they love it, maybe you can keep with a release plan that you currently have. If a customer is telling you that they hate it, maybe all the features that's coming later need to be reviewed. Maybe the design is not okay. Then you update the release plan. Maybe the market shifted. Competitors entered the market. There's something that happened in the market. You need to change the product backlog, the priority. Obviously, the release plan will change. A release plan should be updated. That's why we do Agile. We are constantly maximizing value. We want feedback from customers and we want to deliver what the customers want to use. Even if that means constantly updating the release plan, delivering value to customer is more important than keeping a static release plan and not changing it because someone in middle management or upper management said you should meet that date. No. Most important thing is maximizing value, not meeting a date and delivering things just to deliver things. If you want more tips, insights on Agile, Scrum, personal growth, click on the video that stands out the most on the screen right now, and I'll see you in a few seconds.